into the garden. Holy cow. It's getting harder and harder for me to get through here. I'm saving seeds from my radishes, you know, the French breakfast that I was growing. I decided to leave about, I don't know, a dozen and a half of these. I let them grow up and go to seed because I want to collect the seeds from them. I will have these in a program later on, but I haven't done this for years, so I forgot how big radish plants can get. They get huge and they get filled with pods. They're just freakishly out of control. Crazy things. Once your radishes are no longer edible, when they become woody and overgrown, you can either yank them up and throw them in the compost pile, or you can just let them go to seed and save your seeds till next year. Now, what happens with the French breakfast? Normally they have a really beautiful, light red, delicious bulb, but when they get overgrown, it'll end up turning into this red stem. Sometimes it'll have the bulb still, but it'll turn into this red stem, and the plants become just these crazy monoliths that, look at this, yeah, they'll just grow up with the big leaves, put out these little white flowers, and let me tell you something, these flowers will attract pollinators from all over the place, and that's a good thing. That will bring pollinators into your garden all summer long. This is the end of July, and these plants have been flowering continuously since, I don't know, I think it was sometime in June. Yes, for over a month, they've been flowering, and they've also been putting out pods. This is a radish pod, and inside this pod, this is the product of these flowers, and these pods have seeds inside of them. You know what's really cool about this? It's a dual-purpose plant. You can eat the radishes when they're young, or you can let them form these pods. If you eat these pods, and they're delicious, by the way, crunchy, and they taste very similar to like a cross between a radish and cabbage. It's delicious. It's absolutely delicious. Hey, Rascal, what you doing? Bunny hunt. Yep. But they are absolutely delicious. You can toss these into salads just the way they are. You don't need to blanch them. You don't need to do anything to them. And you'll get more than you can possibly imagine. Look at this. I'm going to move you down close. It's everywhere. Look at that. All over the place. Mountains and mountains of these. But inside each pod are about maybe 3 or 4 seeds, I think. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to let these pods mature until the end of summer, and they'll turn tan color. When they turn tan color, I harvest them, and then I remove the seeds. Uh-oh. Hold on. Helicopter! I don't know what he's doing. Yeah. Okay, let's just wait until he goes. Anyway, these are the radishes. They are fantastic. There's actually a variety called rat tail radish. And those are grown specifically, not for the radish root, but for the radish pods. They produce radish pods like no other plant. A viewer sent me some of those one year, and it was fantastic. I was pulling out radish pods until I was sick of those things. And it took me a long time to get sick of them. You can get them from any kind of radish. Okay, these are French breakfast. You can get them from any kind of radish that you're growing. Just let them go to seed. Let them grow. Let them go nuts. But make sure you have plenty of room. This is getting kind of crazy. I was going to stake them up, but I thought, where are they going to go? So I'm letting them grow over the aisles, and I'm unable to get through them anymore. I generally have to walk over the fence. So there are the rat tail radishes. I also have a little something going on in here. This was where the green onions were growing and still are growing. I have a little bit of green onions still going on down there. You can see them at the bottom of your screen. I've been pulling up green onions. I did a program on how to thin your green onions. And that was a really fun one to do because I got a lot of green onions to eat. Some viewers were also mentioning that you don't have to yank out your onions. You can just snip them off at ground level, right at ground level with a sharp pair of scissors or a knife, and you can take the onion inside and do what you want with it, stick it in your ear, eat it, cook it, whatever you want to do with it, and the onion will grow back. And I thought that was a fantastic idea. I've heard of it before, but I've never practiced the idea before. But with me, I'm just, I don't know, I guess I'm an ogre when it comes to onions. I don't have the time, and it's also hot, you know, so I don't want to be out here going snip, snip. Sniff. So I just grabbed them, I yanked them, beat the dirt off of them, took them inside. But then I started thinking about it. No, I should actually give that a shot. So what I did was I cut the very end off, just the very end, not the whole white bulb, because that's the delicious tender part of the green onion that I love so much. I just cut the very tip of it off with the roots, and I brought them back outside in the evening, and I planted them here, and you can regrow your green onions, so you don't have to have all kinds of seeds in order to do this. You can reuse your green onion bed, and that's exactly what I'm doing here. In the early summer, the green onions stand up and they're just so beautiful. It's picture perfect. I even got some pictures of my green onions. I don't know. I'm one of the few people to go out and take pictures of the green onions. Towards the middle and the end of summer, my green onions start laying down. That's just how they do. They're perfectly edible even when they're starting to lay down, but that's just how they get. They get a little overgrown, they get a little tall, and I'm eating them as fast as I can. I just pull a few of them out a day and I eat a few a day. Now, what I mentioned is that I replanted the roots. So let me swing over here with my little shaky hand and look at what happens. I take them and I space them just a couple inches apart. And look at this. All brand new onion plants all the way down here. I'm going to go all the way over. And then there's another row right here where they're coming up. So for the fall, I'm going to have a whole new set of young, fresh green onions. So I want to thank my viewers for bringing that back to my attention, because you know what? I wouldn't have done it if you wouldn't have mentioned it. So yes, I do appreciate viewer input. It does help me try different things and get outside my comfort zone. So thank you very much for the idea. I am using it and I am loving it. You know, it's really kind of inspiring for me that I can be a gardener for so many decades, and I'm talking decades, not just years, decades. I've been gardening since, I can't even remember how long, just that long. I've been gardening for so long, and there are always new things to grow. The gardening community is always coming out with new methods, all kinds of new stuff and new varieties. Everything is always changing. It's always so dynamic with gardening. I love it. Yeah, look at my grass that I haven't mowed. I was out here with a weed whip and it ran out of string, you know, the string trimmer. So I don't know if you can see the grass, but it's incredibly long here, and it's being fed by my carrot bed. My carrot bed has a lot of compost in it, and I water it and the water goes down to the bottom, and of course it's feeding the weeds outside the bed. There's no weeds inside the bed, but outside the bed, yes, the weeds are getting really tall. I wanted to show you this. This is right next to the beans. I have to pick beans today. It's almost an every other day thing. I'm picking these beans. They look like crap, but they're still producing, so I'm going to keep on picking. I think I'm going to have a few gallons of green beans for this winter, and I really do like the flavor on these. By the way, these are Blue Lake Bush, and I used to grow Landreth. I really do like Landreth, but I'm very impressed with the Blue Lake Bush. I'm going to let a few of these go to seed, and I'm going to save the seeds from the best looking of the pods. But right here is something that I haven't really shown you this season, because it's an end of season thing, carrots. These are carrots right here. Carrots have a beautiful growth to them. They generally prefer full sun with a little bit of afternoon shade. That's my experience, my carrots. And they go extremely crazy. Now, what I've noticed is last year when I was growing dill, I had these caterpillars in here, and I have a lot of butterflies on my property. You can't imagine how many butterflies I have here. I think they're yellow swallowtails, black swallowtails, some kind of swallowtail butterfly. They are everywhere, and they are beautiful. People love butterflies. Butterflies are just a fantastic little creature. They are one of nature's little gems. But you gotta remember, every butterfly comes from a caterpillar, and every caterpillar is nothing but a crawling, eating machine. Food goes in one end, poop comes out the other. It's a constant thing. They will eat so much food in one day, and if they're eating your garden, they can be quite the nuisance. So the swallowtails, they do have a caterpillar, but the caterpillar is something fantastic. I don't know if I've shown this on video. I've shown it in pictures, but take a look at what the swallowtail butterfly caterpillar looks like when it's on my carrots. They are beauties, aren't they? And believe it or not, even with this coloring, this vivid coloring, they can blend in so incredibly well. You'll be looking right at one and you won't even realize it. There's one right here, there's one here. Let me grab one of these. Come on over here. Don't worry, I won't hurt you. And you know, when you touch these, look at what they do. They put out these little orange horns. Yeah, they put out little orange horns trying to scare you away. That is something else. I won't hurt you. No. I have so many carrots. And by the way, these love carrots. carrot greens. They love eating carrot greens. You can see right here, they've decimated the very top of this. If you get a lot of these, they can cause some damage. Okay, see, his horns went back in. He's feeling comfortable with me now. But they can eat a lot of dill. They love dill, cilantro, parsley, carrot greens. They eat a lot of plants. Don't confuse these with tomato hornworms, which eat tomato plants. These are butterfly caterpillars, whereas the hornworm is from a moth. But yeah, they can eat a lot of your carrots and other greens. But I wanted to show you these because aside from being thought of as a pest, they're also one of nature's creatures. And although I'm not Mr. Tree Hugger, I do try to care for as many critters as I can, because I've been on the opposite side of the fence where I used to kill everything that moved and I didn't really care much about nature when I was a kid. And as I've gotten older, I've evolved and to something I believe is better than what I was before, and I'm very happy and comfortable in my skin. So I do care for these things. I have plenty of carrot greens for these creatures, so I'm going to allow them to eat here, and they're going to go into a cocoon, and they're going to come out a big, beautiful butterfly, and the butterfly is going to be something to behold in my garden, and I really do appreciate that. So I do have enough here to share. If I didn't have enough to share, all I would do is pluck these off, and I've seen little itty bitty ones, I've seen really big ones, you see them all different sizes. You really have to look for these things. And what I do is, if there's too many of them, what I'll do is I'll just take these and toss them somewhere else in the yard. Now just a hop, skip, and a jump from the carrots. What I like to jokingly refer to as my favorite vegetable, because it absolutely is not. This is an eggplant. This was quite the impressive plant, but now not so much, because it is being attacked by what's called flea beetles. And if you've never had flea beetles, let me educate you on what a flea beetle is, in case you might have these in your garden. I can show you what they are, show you what they do, and tell you how you can take care of them, okay? This poor plant has been through heck. I am so guilty of not taking care of it because I don't much care for eggplant. Problem is, I seem to be pretty good at growing eggplant. My method of control on this was to just ignore it because it was doing so incredibly well. It was growing fast. It was putting out new leaves faster than the flea beetles could eat. So I didn't see a problem. I don't get involved unless there's a problem that I really think I need to get involved in. I'm kind of a low impact manager. I don't micromanage everything in my garden. Now, if we go down to ground level, I'm going to show you one more shot of these, and it's the last shot I'm going to be showing because I'm going to be harvesting these and getting rid of the plant since I don't need any more. These are eggplants, and I don't know what kind they are. They're just the typical purple ones, I guess. I have a whole bunch of them. There's a whole bunch on the other side as well. I have quite a few for such a small plant, and this plant has two different problems going on that you may see. If you look really close, now you're going to see on some plants, your tomatoes generally, you'll see a yellow halo with brown in the center. That is what's called early blight. This is a classic early blight, and it loves your tomatoes. It also loves other nightshades like potatoes. Tomatoes, potatoes, eggplants, other nightshades. It will go crazy on them. But that's not the only thing going on. See the little holes? Let me go up to a leaf that has a better look on this. Right here. You see, it looks like somebody took a little mini shotgun and blew holes in this, but you can also see little black insects walking around on the leaves. Those are flea beetles. They're so small I couldn't get a close-up without it getting blurry. They run around like little tiny beetles, and I don't know if they can fly, but I know they can hop away when you touch them. They hop away or roll off of the plant. Oh, that one just hopped onto another leaf. They eat holes in your leaves. Look at this. All over the plant, leaves are being decimated on this. Flea beetles can really hurt your plant, but, I use the word but on this, because they're not a game ender. If your plant is healthy, it can outgrow these. You can take care of these incredibly easy by just taking a spray of pyrethrin. Pyrethrin kills on contact, and it won't leave a residue on your plants. Just mist your plants, boom, insta-death for them. Or if you don't have pyrethrin and you want to make a quick spray, 50% alcohol, 50% water in a spray bottle, mix it up really good, mist these plants. Whenever you spray plants for insects, always do it in the evening or morning when the sun is not on the plants. Because during the hot of the day, especially when it's this hot, it can damage your plants quite a bit to be spraying them, because it really will stress them out. Anyway, those are flea beetles, and that's how to get rid of them. How you doing? They're all over the freaking place. These are the boxcar willies. Yes, these are the boxcar willie, singular. This is the one plant that went nuts. And it's still flowering. It's flowering. There's mosquitoes everywhere today. Lovely. They are fruiting. They are flowering. They're growing. It's just a crazy mess here. I really got in a little over my head with this plant. But that's okay. I like being in over my head with my garden. And they're actually fighting for space with the basil. I gave out seeds in the 2016 free seed giveaway. One of them was a basil. It's called Genovese or something weird. Like, I'm not really quite sure what the basil was called. It was supposed to be a small, flavorful basil. Turns out it's not quite so small when you give it a lot of compost. This is the basil, and it's actually starting to flower right now. I think that's pretty neat because it's bringing in pollinators. I have basil, I have cilantro, and I have parsley. The parsley and cilantro look identical when it comes to flowering, and I'm getting seeds from both of those. So all three of these are putting out flowers, and I've never seen basil flowers before. And I'm just snipping off these leaves as fast as I possibly can. Boy, all you have to do is think about touching a basil leaf, and the smell comes out. Oh, it's a remarkable smell. You know me. I like good smells. I'm really big on smells. I'm always sniffing things in my garden. And tomatoes have a really good smell. We've been having the heat wave, as I mentioned in a previous episode. And the heat wave does really good things. It can do some bad things, but it can also do some good things. Tomatoes and peppers love heat. And when the heat comes on, they go nuts. At least here in Iowa, they do. The boxcar willie has gone nuts. It's showing stress on the leaves. And when your leaves start curling in, during the heat, that just means stress. And there's nothing you can do about it except to shade them, and I'm not going to do that here. I'm just going to let them do whatever they want to do, because they are producing and they're doing just fine. Now, one thing I've noticed on these tomatoes is that they're starting to crack. Cracking is not a game ender for tomatoes. It doesn't affect the flavor. All it affects is the looks. And like I said, I'm not growing for a beauty contest. I'm growing for food. A cracked tomato tastes just like a regular tomato. Let me show what cracking is and tell you exactly how it's caused. Towards the end of July, they start turning from a sea of green balls to yellow, light green, orange, red. It's a beautiful thing to see. And these, there are quite a few of them. I'm going to just give you a really, really quick scan of the tomatoes. And they're hidden. Yep, this is like Easter. Yeah, you got to pull the leaves aside. Look at that. Thing's huge. It is a really good size. They're everywhere. You can't move a leaf without seeing a tomato. There are a lot. I have way more tomatoes than I can possibly use this year once I start canning. And this is the size that they're supposed to be, like a small beef steak. Boxcar willie is not known for being huge, but then again, boxcar willie has a mind of its own. Let me go over here. And this thing is like one of those huge beef steaks you see in the grocery store. And it's not even done. It's got a twin down there too. Yeah, they're all over the place. Now, that's a really good thing. I got a lot of tomatoes. I've done really well with the tomato plant this year. But I wanted to show you something. I'm not here to brag about my tomatoes. I'm here to show you an issue that you may be having with your tomatoes. This, let me sit down. I got the camera in my hands. Right next, oh, by the way, look at this. Here's the flowers from the basil. Isn't that something? I just wanted to show you because I've never seen them in my life. I've never seen basil flowers. It's quite elegant. Anyway, right next to the elegance is the tomato. This is what's called tomato cracking. This is not a disease. This is not a problem that you really have to be concerned about. All that's happening is sometimes you get a really heavy rain, and right now some parts of the country are getting heavy rains, and you'll be noticing this happening with your tomato. When you get heavy rains, the tomato plant takes in water really, really quick and shoves it to the tomatoes. Well, the tomatoes expand so much faster than their skins can expand, and that forms cracking. It just literally cracks open, seals up, to make room for the expansion of the tomatoes. You see, these aren't supposed to be this big. So generally, I'm going to have a normal sized tomato. That would be this, and it's not going to crack. But the ones that are cracking tend to be the ones that are getting oversized. And I think that has something to do with the fact that I put so much compost in here. And this is an incredibly nitrogen-rich compost. And nitrogen does not mean that you're just going to get green growth with no production of fruit, because otherwise I wouldn't be showing you 100,000 tomatoes on one plant. Now, nitrogen will help them grow really fast, a lot of green, but if you have the other minerals and nutrients in your soil, it'll grow well balanced. It'll use the minerals and nutrients and nitrogen in the amounts that it needs. The plant knows what to do. All you have to do is give it what it needs. Now with the cracking, nothing you can do about it except accept it. And that's what I'm doing. I'm accepting the fact that some of my tomatoes, the larger ones, are going to crack. And that's just fine with me. I'll pick them, I will cut them open, and I will eat them, and I will enjoy them every bit as much as the perfect looking ones. It doesn't matter to me what they look like. I wanted to show you the tomatoes because they are really going nuts. And they're still flowering. Yes, they are. They still have the little flowers coming out. See, little teeny tiny flowers that are dying off. And then as soon as the flowers are done, we get the itty bitty tomatoes. This thing is going to go bonkers all the way until, I don't know, until the frost kills it. And you know what's kind of contradictory to what people will say? I've had this in my other tomato programs. See how my tomatoes are touching the dirt. They're laying right on the dirt. The vines are crawling right along. But do you see blight anywhere? Do you see the blight? No, there is no blight. And there are no rotting tomatoes on the ground. They're not rotting because they're touching the ground. That is a myth. People will tell you, well, if your tomatoes touch the ground, they'll rot. Well, they may rot, and that's only if you have an unhealthy plant or you have unhealthy soil. Just because a tomato touches the ground does not instantly mean it's going to rot. There has to be a reason for that. So you need to find the reason in order to correct the situation. So this is not a miracle garden, and so I just want to tell you that it doesn't mean that your plants are going to rot and your tomatoes are going to rot just because they touch the ground. Mine are living proof of that. It just makes it all worthwhile, doesn't it? When you start harvesting from your garden, everything smells and tastes. It just tastes like a brand new day. It does. It's absolutely beautiful. This is worth it. This is definitely worth it. The sun just came out. Right on cue. It's a perfect day today. And thank you, everybody, for joining me in the garden. And like I always say, if you have a question concerning your garden, anything having to do with growing stuff, or you just want to say hello, please feel free to post it in the comment section below. If you have a question, post it in the comment section below. I'll do my very best to give you the very best answer I possibly can. So the tomato and I are headed into the house. One of us is not coming out alive. Have a great day, everybody. Best of luck in your garden. Oh, rascal, let's go.